what I'll call our. So please talk to them and find out what this group is about. And we would love to have you join us any second Monday, 11:30 to 1. And we try to have a variety of topics, as I said, to learn, share, and celebrate the history of this unique area. But this morning, our history is going to go back about as far as it does in terms of what we have been able to record. If people have been, European settlers have been in this area about 150 years, and that's probably where you're going to start, would be my guess. So many of you know Phil, and if you don't know Phil, it's because you haven't been out. the name Phil Barnes has come up in so many different things that I've been associated with over the years. And when I got his official bio, it was like, yeah, that connection, and that connection, and that connection, and that connection. Professionally, philanthropically, from a volunteer standpoint, from a governmental standpoint, from an education standpoint, you've just done it all. So I'm going to get out of the way and let him take up our time. And you'll have to let us know if you want for us to have questions as we go, or if you want us to save them to the end. But let's welcome Phil.
Well, thank you, Ellen. And it's obvious that from what she said that I'm simply old. I do want to obviously acknowledge the folks from Westlake Pres who are kind enough to come today. The fear I've got is that all of you know so much that you can keep me honest through some of what I have to say. This project was really undertaken at the request of our pastors. We are, in 2024, we'll be celebrating 150 years as a worshiping community. And that's a term of art. And out of this, the idea came that, well, maybe we could produce a book. Book something that pulls together much of the been available, but in different places. So it would be a document that carries forward this history. And that was the task that I have undertaken. The work really is an attempt to pull together through photographs, images of documents, archival materials. And I did ask, I've forgotten now, Stacy may remember, probably 50 members of our church community who had been members for a number of years to just share with us their reflections about what it meant to them, what they found when they came to Westlake Pres. Those have been a rich source of information. Help fill in some pieces and also to give a perspective about what the church has meant to them. That collection will be a part of the archives that we'll leave behind from this work. As we're gathering this material, a part of the effort is also to make sure that the various documents that we've collected are assembled in one place so they will be there as for the future for people looking back at this who would like to know more. I do want to acknowledge the wonderful Dorothy Depew and her husband Stanley. He was a photographer. They owned Westlake Beach, and over many years, our community, our church, enjoyed the hospitality of the Depews. Dorothy was also quite an accomplished historian. And she really was the one responsible for collecting a lot of the information and pulling it together that was reflected in the book that she did with a co-author called Eanes, the Portrait of a Community. And for those who are interested in the larger Eanes community, as well as the history of our church, that's a wonderful resource. And I would encourage you to take a look at it. The other excellent descriptions of life in the hill country, really before electricity, are found in Ken Roberts' The Cedar Choppers, The Life on the Edge of Nothing, and Ellen shared with me, I think, that Ken is going to be a guest here next month or sometime soon, and I would encourage you to come. I've heard him speak. I wrote his book. It's an extraordinary experience and insight into what life in this community was like and in the surrounding hill country areas 150 years ago. And then, of course, the great Robert Caro's biography of Lyndon Johnson, the first volume is 100 pages, the first chapter, the first volume, about the history of the hill country and what life was like. So those are sources to go to, very authoritative, very informative. And I will tell you, the bottom line of all that is that life in the hill country prior to electricity, which probably came here about 1937, was primitive. It was hard. You think about not having electricity, what that means. It means you cook with fire. You haul water. If you were lucky, you had a well. Otherwise, you went to a stream. You washed your clothes by hand, hung them on bushes. It was hard. It was a hard life. The roads out here were primitive. In fact, what's now BK Road was the road to Llano. It was unpaved, pockmarked. You could hardly get a car, once we got cars, out this way. It's hard for us to remember today just what life was like at that era. And really, right up until the early 40s. And in some extent, even later. Now, the church history, and I will apologize to those of you who are not from Westlake Pres, that a lot of what I'm going to talk about in the early years really relates to the whole community, because it was so critical to how our church evolved. But later, we're into a lot of Presbyterian stuff and into the weeds about our church that those of you from other places might not have as much appreciation for. And I certainly would understand that. The church history has at least three essential components. And they're the shown in the red on the left. And that is beginning with the worshiping community itself. And then the role of preaching and teaching, that of the pastors, those who are called to the word and sacrament. And then, of course, preparing a place, the physical place where worship occurs. And those three things are what are the lenses through which I had hoped to develop what happened on the right side. The worshiping community in the early years of 1874 to 1923. And that period of time, the little chapel, the worshiping chapel, and you can see some images back of the table that Ellen provided, that it was a non-denominational, for lack of a better term, congregational in a sense, but it was very small. And then from 1923 to 1954, I call that the Eanes Presbyterian era, and I'll talk a little bit more about how that happened. And then in 54, from 54 to 83, these are the early years of Westlake Pres itself. And then from 83 until 2000, till today, is what we might consider the modern era. Actually, the modern era probably began in 76. But the move to our new site occurred in 83. Now, let's see. Now, these are images you'll recognize from Dorothy Depew's book. I know you can't read that, but this is Robert and Eanes and Eliza Eanes. They moved to the area in 1872 and were very important to the early development of the whole community. That Robert Eanes built the first schoolhouse on his property, which was a log cabin, in 1872. Below them are images of H.B. and Viola Marshall, who were descendants and also extraordinarily important in the development of the community and our church. The Teagues, William and Sophie Teague, gave 2 acres of land for the purposes of church and school. He came to Texas from Arkansas in 1860. She was an immigrant from Poland who had actually been separated from her father when they arrived in Galveston, and she made her way to this part of the country by herself. She married and was widowed with 2 children when she married William T. She was a formidable personality. They settled on 500 acres near the Eanes Ranch. This is a document, and actually there's another copy of it on the table, that transfers the property, the 2 acres of property, and I wish you could read this, but it talks about the purposes of a church and school, and the 2 acres that was deeded by William and Sophie Teague, and you'll notice that it's signed with an X, because they were not literate, which is so interesting. This was similar. This is an image, again, from Dorothy's collection. This is an image of a log cabin that was similar to the one that was built by Robert Eanes. This one actually was in Zilker Park. The clapboard first wooden structure was then subsequently built in 1872. Excuse me, and it then burned in 1874. Burned in 1892 and was rebuilt in 1896. And it served as this church, school, and chapel until 1928. There's a picture of a class in 1902 from that little school. Now, for the first 50 years, the church was really served by itinerant preachers. They were Baptists, Methodists, and maybe Campbellites, somebody thought. Campbellites, by the way, is a division of the Church of Christ. And what was common about all of these traditions is that the pastors could become pastors without any kind of formal education. And that permitted those denominations to grow across the South way ahead of the Presbyterians, who always insisted upon the formal education of the clergy. Now, today, it's quite true that all of these other traditions also have seminaries and put an emphasis upon the educated clergy. But that was not true in 1875. And even until the early 20s. So the Austin Presbyterian Theological Seminary was established in 1902. So our little church had been there for 25 plus years, for a generation, even before the seminary was established. The educated clergy is really an important part of our history because it opens up and acknowledges the importance of the life of the mind. And it permits us intellectually to pursue an understanding of scriptures and a larger world through a different lens that has been extraordinarily important, I think, to attracting people to the Presbyterian Church. I've always been amazed. We have some in our audience today of the physicians, doctors, people of science who have been attracted to the Presbyterian Church. Partly, I think, in my mind, because of its openness, its intellectual honesty, its willingness to hear and listen, explore and understand. And it's been extraordinarily, in my mind, powerful. The Professor Robert Gribble, well, about 1923, actually, the leaders of our church, little church, reached out, the oral history says, we need a permanent pastor. We need a pastor instead of just relying upon whoever can show up. So the story is they went to the Methodist bishop in Austin and asked him to assign a pastor. But the bishop declined because this country was just too rough. It was too remote. We couldn't possibly expect one of our pastors to permanently serve that church. At least that's the legend. And there is some oral history to support that. Professor Robert Gribble, who's actually shown here in a picture in 1942, but he was 20 years younger, learned of our need for a pastor, and by invitation from our folks, he offered to assign seminary students to preach on Sundays. And they began that tradition, and actually it carried on for a good number of years. And then in 1923, and this is a document, a copy of a letter, and again, I apologize, you can't possibly read this, but the date is 1929, but it says, to whom it may concern, during the month of March 1923, with the assistance of Mr. C.P. McElroy, a student at Austin Presbyterian Theological Seminary, a church was organized. And the letter then identifies the people. And some of these names you certainly will recognize who were a part of the original organization of this Presbyterian church. 13 of these people came into the church on profession of faith, and 7 by letter, including such names as Randolph Johnson, Mrs. E.H. Johnson, H.B. Marshall, Mrs. H.B. Marshall, names that are iconic in the history of our church. 1923 begins the relationship, really, of our affiliation with the Presbyterian denomination. Now, this is again from an oral history. And it says about 40 years ago, the little church building burned and was replaced by the present frame house erected by H.B. Marshall, Henry Johnson, and John Carlson. During a lull in the work, on invitation of the community, a student in the Presbyterian Theological Seminary began to conduct worship. And because of the ready availability of student assistance and the help of the faculty, it seemed best of all concerned that the Presbyterian should take over the work. And they did. And here we go. This is the little rock stone building. And again, there are pictures of it back here that Ellen has provided. It was begun in 1928 and was finally dedicated in 1932. And the interesting thing is that Dr. Gribble himself, his professor, who had been involved in the church, along with Mrs. H.B. Marshall, the two of them carried the debt on the personal notes to help finance that stone church. Our debt to Austin Seminary is huge. It goes way back. Can you imagine what level of commitment it took for somebody to take that personal risk? Now, as this note suggested, the debt is all paid off. So it was retired. Historical marker was placed. This is the program of dedication. And again, there's another copy of it back here in the Dublin that's provided. As you can see, and it's the program of dedication for Eanes Presbyterian Church. The Eanes Presbyterian Church. Over the years, it had been referred to as the Eanes Chapel, the Eanes Church. But really, we know by this date in 1932, it was clearly the Eanes Presbyterian Church. Now, by 1953, when Westlake Pres was organized, and you'll see on the picture back there of the, I may have it here. If you read this carefully, you can't read that, but it says Westlake Hills Presbyterian. But that's probably about 1953, when Westlake was actually chartered as a church, incorporated as a church. There's the marker that thanks to people really interested in the history of this era, about 1970, this marker was established to acknowledge the important history of that little stone building, which still exists. It's on the campus of the elementary school. And there's pictures of it back there. It doesn't look exactly like it did. They put windows in it, but it's still functional. In 1953, the session of Eanes Church, Eanes Presbyterian Church, approved a proposal, or the session approved a proposal for the organization of what they call the Eanes Presbyterian Church. And that's in our minutes. That day, the session of University Presbyterian Church was present. That day, let me pause for a moment and talk about that time between 1932 and 1954. Really, during the Depression and World War II was a difficult time for the country, certainly for this area. And as one of the oral histories reports, the church during that time became, quote, disorganized. It just became disorganized. The men had gone to war. There was too much poverty. It was just, quote, disorganized. But after the war students from the Mission Committee of the Presbyterian Student League, later named the Westminster Student Fellowship of the University Presbyterian Church, they assigned people that came and helped. And this is a list of students who had preached over the years, up until 1947, students from the seminary who had served our little church. Then the proposal was created to establish the church officially as a Presbyterian church. At that time in 1953, as a mission of UPC, the Eanes Community Church had 92 communicants and 30 families. The proposal also requested that Eanes Independent School District pay a fair amount for the school church and building and grounds, the 2 acres the Teagues had given us all those years before. That if they could establish that, if they could do that, that would permit them to take a master plan for a new building of about 4,100 square feet. If they could then find the property and move and build a new little church. They actually had a survey of the church to establish what the name should be. And that's where the name Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church was one of the options put forward, and that was the name that was selected. That was in 1953. So in 1954, here's a copy of the charter that was issued by the state of Texas. Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church is certified as a nonprofit corporation. Those are the articles of incorporation. This is a copy of the sale document that was agreed to, and you can see it signed at the bottom. And if you, again, I wish you could read it, you can see it. But the total price for the property, the 2 acres, was $4,500.
And the building.
So there you go, $4,500. And of that amount, so much is paid, $1,500 paid initially, and so on. You can see the signatories for Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church was Williams, Edwards, and Hendricksons. And here are the signatures for the Eanes Independent School District, affirming that sale. And that really did mark the beginning of Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church as we came to know it today, or the end of what would be from 1874 to 1954, essentially, that period of time. And what is that? Somebody do that arithmetic for me real quick. 80 years, is that right? Yeah, an 80-year period. Now, then we had the opportunity to call a pastor. Now, this was the first time that there was actually a call extended to a Presbyterian pastor to serve Westlake Hills Pres. And this little news item appeared in something called the Town Crier in September of 1954. And it says the pulpit committee from Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church went to Louisiana this past weekend to issue a call to a new minister, the Reverend Robert Gage. The church has been without a permanent pastor for the past several months. Oh, yeah, well, how about the past 80 years? Going to Louisiana to issue the call were Harv Womack, Mr. and Mrs. Randolph Johnson, Miss Benny Ruth Beard, Miss Alta Rose Billion, and Mrs. Robert D. Edwards. Again, names that are embedded in the history of our church. Now, Pastor Gage, I couldn't find a photograph of it. I looked everywhere. I just couldn't find one. So we don't know exactly what he looked like. But the work of the committee went forward, and this was the initial drawing that they had done. This is a hand-drawn, essentially, plan for what the little church would look like. And this was the plan as was ultimately adopted for the church at the located at the corner of Westlake Drive and Big Cave Road, about 4,000 square feet. And you can see when they set out areas for Sunday school, classrooms. Sunday school has always been an integral part of the work of the church. Now, this price, incidentally, the price for the construction, 4,200 square feet, at a price $41,000. In 1956 is when this was actually constructed. And there it is. And that building still exists at the corner of Westlake Drive and DK Road. And if you look carefully when you drive by, don't look too hard unless you stop. You get run over. You can still see this end of the church from DK Road. It's now a bank. It went through other iterations, including for a time, it was the home of St. John Newman Catholic Church, until they could rebuild their wonderful facility where it is at the road. This is David Evans. Now, he was a student at Austin Presbyterian Seminary. And it was recommended that he be invited to serve as a student supply to preach 3 Sundays each month for 8 months. And this was all sort of preordained because we knew we were going to call him as our next pastor. But he had to graduate. He had to complete that education, which he did. And in 1956, he was called. And he served for 2 years. And he went on to a long and distinguished career as a Presbyterian pastor. Here's a picture of, as the new building was built, we then added, subsequently added a fellowship hall, which we call Ross Hall, in 1957. This is Dave Edwards overseeing, along with R.D. Edwards, A.W. Bryan, R.D. Johnson, as they lay the cornerstone for what became we call Ross Hall, that a fellowship hall at the church. That cornerstone, by the way, we carried forward with us when we moved to Westlake Press, and you'll find it on the wall, the exterior of our church. It's a reminder of that history. And things went on. This is a picture during this period of time using the sanctuary for all sorts of purposes. It's the stewardship campaign, something that recurs in the Presbyterian Church. And I expect it's also true in virtually every other Protestant denomination. Now, when Dave Evans left to take a call, again, we turned to the seminary. And the seminary assigned and permitted its librarian, actually, Norman Dow, to come out to serve as an interim. And he did that for a year. And actually, he was an extraordinary person. He was a collector, a librarian, and a collector of rare books. And his collection is actually acknowledged in places as being really extraordinary. He was then succeeded, we call John Coffin Jr. John Coffin, picture on the right. He came with the understanding that he would return after a relatively short period of time to the mission field, for he felt this was his ultimate calling. Years later, I found a letter going through this stacks of stuff that we've got. I found a letter that he had written, and it was addressed to whomever opens the mail at Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church. It is a sweet letter. And again, I'll read briefly from it for you. It was written in 2008, and as he said, I'm 80 years old, and I've been reflecting on my life, and I came back and visited the Westlake area that he had served those many years before, and had seen all the changes that had taken place. And he said, the roots of this church were planted at the Eanes, his spelling, elementary school at the corner of Beekers Road and Camp Creek Road. Well, he was kind of forgot the actual name. This became a preaching point primarily for students at Austin Seminary. He was reflecting on this history. The area was sparsely populated. The early settlers who still lived in the area were called cedar choppers. The hilly land was not suitable for farming, and the primary source of income for these folks was cutting the numerous cedar trees, making them for fence posts. The other newer group making up the population were primarily folks with an independent streak who were professors from the University of Texas and others who admired the beautiful hill country rising from the Colorado River on the west side of Austin. And this is really interesting. The combination of highly educated with those with little or no formal education made an interesting mixture of people. At that time, the session of the church was about evenly divided between these two groups. Among the six members were PhDs and at least one member who was barely literate.
Wow.
I was surprised at how well the members of the disparate group accepted each other and worked in harmony. In addition to their common Christian faith was the love of nature and the beauty of the hills. It's a sweet letter. And he goes on to talk about his experience, and I'll highlight one of it. I was 30 years old, I'm fairly small, and I've always had a rather boyish look. My solution to the problem led me to drive into Austin and buy a distinguished looking black hat. A few days later, I made another visit to the house and knocked on the door. And inside came a voice saying, "Mother, someone's at the door." Again, the question, "Who is it?" The boy's answer, "I don't know. He looks like an undertaker." But this business, this practice of calling on people, of the pastors and members of the session calling on people, was a tradition. And it carried on. The new education wing was added in 1963. And this is from Harry Vide's reflections. Let me note, those of you that may have known Harry and Louise Vide, they were other members of our church. They joined, were accepted into fellowship in 1959. So Louise and Harry died a few years later. Louise lived and really served with six of our eight installed pastors and three of our interns. She was on the committee that called Doug Fletcher, a remarkable person, a wonderful gift to our church. But anyway, Harry was reflecting on the building of the wing. And he says, plans were prepared, a contractor was hired, and construction started. But problems, quote, too numerous to mention, brought the work to a halt. According to Harry Vine, for some reason, no staircase had been designed to get to the second floor. And if it had not been for Willie Walker and Randolph Johnson, who supervised the contractors, we'd be using a ladder to get to the second floor. Again, look at the names. Randolph Johnson, again, to the rescue. This is Tom McGee, and his wife, Shirley. It's a picture taken in February 14, the Valentine's Day celebration in 1965. He served our church from 63 to 67. But he felt his call ultimately, he was honest about this when he came, he felt his call was ultimately in counseling. And after leaving us, he went back to UT and earned his PhD in counseling and had a distinguished career as a college counselor. Again, this is a picture probably taken by Stanley Depew of the worshiping in the sanctuary, and that's Tom McGee in the pulpit. Now, this is a great picture of the session. And now, what do you see about this picture that's unremarkable and remarkable at the same time?
No
women. Yes. How many women do you see in this picture on the governing body of the church at Westlake? And this was in 1964. It was about that time in 64 that the Southern Church, meaning the Southern Presbyterian Church, actually permitted the ordination of women to offices of deacon or elder. Louise Vine, not too long after that, was among the first of our congregation ordained as an elder. And she told a great story about the first time she said it was an honor. It was such a privilege to feel that call that she was serving communion. And one of the women in the congregation looked up at her and said, "Are you a women's liver?" Times have changed. Again, the church, the life of the church was healthy. And we were continuing to grow. This is a record Sunday, June 12th, 1964. Look at those sweet kids in Sunday school. Here we are again, 65. And in 68, we called James Mosley. Now, Jim Mosley was a much loved pastor. He was here for 8 years, and as of today, would have been our third longest serving pastor. We expect in another couple of years, he would have been our fourth longest serving pastor, as Emily will have passed his tenure. We're prayerfully hoping. Anyway, he was much loved. He likely would have stayed longer, but he felt the need to return to Arkansas to care for his aging parents. And so when Jim was here, though, we did a lot, including the manse. Now, the manse has been an interesting history. Most of you may not have known we ever had a manse, but we did. We had two, actually. And this little history reviews it. In 1954, Randolph Johnson, yet again, gave the church an acre of land and a well on Allen Road, which is down here near Camp Croft, Camp Craft, for a manse. The plans were completed, and estimated cost of $12,600, and it was completed in that year. The Reverends Gage, Evans, Coffin, and McGee lived in the original manse. So we had a manse. It was a little removed from the church. In 1967, we purchased 1.1 acres of land adjacent to our property at the corner of Westlake Drive and BK Road. And that was financed by an $8,500 loan from the Austin Presbyterian Church U.S. Development Board. Again, the Presbyterians were helping. The larger Presbyterian Church was helping us establish to acquire that property. And then we hired Walter Carrick, a name familiar to many of us, for the construction of a quote custom mats to be built on that site at a cost of $26,000. The loan was ultimately repaid, and the Reverend and his family lived in the mats from 68 until 75. By the time Gary Dennis was called in 76, the church was badly in need of additional classroom space. We were growing and growing. And Gary and Sarah, his wife, really preferred to live in a home in the community as opposed to right next door to the church. And so those arrangements were made, and the mats was converted to a classroom space. This is other life of the church. These are names some of you would know. And these will again be easier to see once the book finally comes out. It was interesting that this is a picture here, and this picture of Allison Snyder. Now, Allison Snyder is the daughter of Dave Snyder. And we had Dave's memorial service at Westlake Pres last week. They were members, active members of Westlake Pres from the early middle 60s. And these are other names that would be familiar to you. A trip to Mo Ranch, another of the iconic institutions. Barbara Johnson, Thelma Yockey, Henrietta Gaber, Edith Ferguson, and others. Church members enjoying an outing at Westlake Beach, again, owned by the Depew family, and a place where many outings were held. Christmas pageants were part of the life of this little church. This is 1972. Ken and Marguerite Dabbs in 1975. And this is Ken Dabbs here. And Marguerite and their children and some others who were admitted into membership. Now, many of you knew Ken Dabbs. He was the first, and again, this goes back to the ties between the school and the church. He was the first football coach at Westlake High School. And much loved. He was a really good guy. Darrell Royal recruited him to the University of Texas, where he became best known for being the person who really recruited Earl Campbell to Texas. And Ken and Marguerite Dabbs are really sweet people. Ken died, what, 2 years ago, 3 years ago? And his ashes are in urn in our new, at that time, memorial garden. So Ken was a part of our church for all of those years. Now, also, interestingly enough, we were attracted to a lot of the athletic folks from the University of Texas. I can't fully explain why, except it's just a great place and a wonderful church. But Dave and Nancy Snyder, Dave was the tennis coach. That was his daughter's picture I showed you earlier. Dave was the tennis coach at UT for 27 years. Nancy was actually on our staff for a short time. But they left and went to the Methodist Church. Ken and Margaret Dabbs talked about Pat and Jane Patterson. Jane was the swim coach at Westlake High School. Pat Patterson was a swim coach at UT. Both were active in our congregation. I served in the session with Pat.
Something else cool I found out from talking to him last week.
Sure.
Pat was also the principal at Westlake High School.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Okay. Yes, he got a $20,000 pay raise. That's why he came.
And if pile there on my backside. Pat's still very active in swimming and everything. His daughter Christy's a big high school coach at the Westlake. The Westlake team was at the state meet a couple of years ago, and my buddy was wearing a shirt.
Yeah.
Pat Patterson walked up to him and goes, "Who's the greatest athlete and the greatest principal ever at Westlake High School?" He said, "I'll answer for you, Kelly Gruber and me."
There you go.
Had to there be 85 years old. Still,
that is an amazing man. He really is. Eddie and Eleanor Reese. Eddie and Eleanor and Pat and I were in the same new members class together. We actually started attending Westlake in 1976, about a month after Gary Dennis arrived. It was a year or two later when we joined. Eddie, of course, became the legendary swim coach at UT. And it was interesting, the relationship he had with Pat Patterson. Because here was a man who, for all practical purposes, was eased out in favor of the coach who was somewhat younger, had a rising career, and yet they became good friends, welcomed him to our family of faith. It's a sweet story. It's a great story. And, of course, Eddie Reese was one of the Eddie was one of the eulogists at Dave Snyder's memorial service. And then, of course, Daryl and Edith Royal. Edith was more active as a member of the church, and she still is a member, although she's at Corinthia. Daryl, of course, was an iconic figure, not only here, but around any place in Texas, and for that matter, the country. Ted Wardlaw, who was recently retired as president of Austin Seminary, tells a story of being invited to our pulpit. And he was preaching one Sunday. And then after the service, he was outside greeting people as they came by. And this fellow came up, and Ted said, "You know, you look familiar to me. Somebody else you know." He said, "Yeah, I'm Daryl Royal." Even DeLoss and Mary Dodds were members. Now, when Jim Mosley left, we called as an interim a man, a pastor named Malcolm Purcell. He served for a year. And again, he had had a long career himself in the Presbyterian Church. At the time, he was taking a leave, at this time as an associate pastor at First Southern, to come out and serve as our interim. He was near the end of his career. He had been a senior pastor and he had served in the church in other capacities for years. Again, the Presbyterians have a system of providing these pastors and making pastors available to be called. Now, Gary Dennis came in 1976, and he served until 1990, almost 14 years. This was an extraordinary time in the life of our church. A graduate of Princeton, he had served as an associate pastor of churches in Los Angeles and Memphis, big churches, and was planning to pursue a graduate degree in theology at Edinburgh, Scotland. And he had been reached out by the search committee at Westlake. So he went to council with James Dr. McCord, who was president of Princeton Seminary. And according to the story, McCord, who had also been a dean at Austin, McCord is reported to have said, "Gary, Sarah, your wife, does not want to go to Scotland. She's pregnant with her second child. You need to go to Austin and take that call to Westlake Hills," which is what he did. mountain climbing pastor. He brought an enthusiasm. He was 30 years old when he came to Westlake. And it was a whole new era, a whole new look for the church, who had been served well and faithfully by older pastors from another tradition. And Gary came with a different view, with a certain level of excitement and a commitment to youth. He really believed in the importance of bringing up young people. And he wanted the message of the church to be a little more edgy. He emphasized, and here we go, by 78, we had called the first associate pastor. This is a picture of Gary and Sarah and Bill and Ann Edwards. That was the first time that we had reached the point where we needed a multiple staff. In 1977, Gary asked Jeannie Johnson, a member of the church, to plan and organize a new school of pre-kindergarten children. The school opened later that year and became a great success. And this is a little description from the staff written some years ago about the school. One of the features, because it was one of the first, if not the first, of the schools of its type, preschools in this area, was immensely popular. And so finally, the decision was made to give priority to our members, which is logical, but it also had the unintended but happy consequence of encouraging people to join. So it became, in its own way, an outreach to the community, bringing people to the church, many of whom did become members for whatever reason, including the ability to have their children in preschool. Gary also emphasized the importance of Bible study. And it's not that it hadn't always been a component of who we were, but he went about it in a little different way. For example, he organized a weekly Bible study at the Headliners Club for people who worked downtown or in that area. And then the reflections I got back from people talked about how important that Bible study was to them. And let me just, again, I wish you'll be able to read this someday. Roger Berry, we started attending in the fall of 1990. I became acquainted through the downtown Headliners Bible study. We were immediately impressed by two things. First, the sincere and authentic faith we encountered from so many people. Secondly, the people were friendly, healthy, and fun to be around. Rick Milvanen, from the 80s, I was a regular attender of the Headliners Bible study. Gary Dennis would come and discuss the passage he was preaching from the following Sunday. The group was always delighted when one of our comments made it into a sermon. And Fred Wilder, still a member, these are still members of our church. Fred Wilder, a physician, also began attending the Headliner study shortly after we came to Austin, and in fact arranged my clinic schedule so that I could attend every week. This allowed me to get to know Gary very well, and was a development, a milestone in my walk of faith. How interesting. Well, the growth was continuing. By 1979, plans were approved and construction began on a new sanctuary, adding to the existing little building on BK Road and Westlake Drive. The new sanctuary that would seat about 500 people in the round, it's a hexagonal shape structure. It's still there, by the way. And the dedication occurred in April of 1980. Easter Sunday that year, we had the new sanctuary was completed, but we didn't have an occupancy permit. And on that Sunday, the crowd that came on Easter began to fill up the little sanctuary we're using in Ross Hall. People were standing outside. It was really, really crowded. So Gary said, grab the Easter lilies. We're going to go to the new sanctuary. So we picked them up, marched down to the new sanctuary, and it overflowed. The first Sunday, of course it was Easter, but the first Sunday, we overflowed that sanctuary. And I can still remember the feeling, having incurred the debt, what we need to do to build this. Now what do we do? What's the next step? Gary had a vision for something called the Family Life Center. He wanted to build a gymnasium with facilities, kitchen facilities, where we could entertain and have young people and do other things that would permit the church to serve a broader community. And that, this is a picture from the newspaper showing this is the original church. This is the church here on the right. You can see the new sanctuary at the top. And this was the planned Family Life Center. It would have been bigger than the entire church. Well, it was just too much building. And in spite of all the people in real estate and other connections that we had in our congregation, and quite properly, the Zoning Commission and the Westlake Village of Westlake would never permit the construction to occur, and they were exactly right. Where would you have parked? It was just too much for that site. And so we began then the search for a new location. And by the way, we were raising money for that. This is a picture from the Tribune of a gift made from SB Houston. At that time, Joe Beale was a member of the congregation and supporting that church. We also took a look at where our trends were, what was happening in the community, what was going on, what could possibly justify this growth. And this chart shows a summary of the findings that were made. And our church size at that time, as measured by the number of people worshiping each Sunday, was already larger than 98% of the Presbyterian churches in America. This would be 1980-81, and so on. So the projections suggested that we really had the ability and the means to make a move, but move to where? And this is an image showing the various sites that were looked at and people talked about to make that move. And they included, you can see, property all along 360. But the Cowan property, which is shown right here, was some 40 plus acres of land. It was owned by Will Cowan, who was a member of the church. And eventually that was where the site committee chose. Negotiations are underway, and we bought about 40, 45 acres. The actual number is a little bit unclear because of how the lines were drawn. But we bought that property for $550,000, 40 plus acres on Bee Cave Road. It was the corner of Bee Cave and Barton Springs Road. Today, the property is 35.1 acres. We had deeded off somewhere between 10 and 12 acres to the city of Austin in order to protect our development rights and the rest of the site. There is an interesting period of time. This, by the way, is what it looked like. Big Cave Road is a two-lane road. 360 was not yet completed, but was underway. And this was it. We drive up, you actually had to take down a barbed wire fence in order to drive onto the property. There was no Barton Creek development. There was none of that stuff back there. Nothing west of there was that. And people were clearly and understandably thinking, what are you people doing? And yet we had the belief that the growth would come. Every indication was that it would come. And of course, it did. Gary has a great story about that period of time. This is the property, by the way. It's the picture of it. You can see this area that's clearly undeveloped. The church up here at the top goes a lot of this way, all the way down, originally down to Barton Creek. We ceded off some 10 or 12 acres to the city. This is the Capital Campaign Steering Committee, made up again of some people and some names that many of you would recognize. The original cost of the church, looking back, is now estimated at about $3.5 million, of which we borrowed, again, and reported in the Echo. The good news is that the National Bank of Commerce said we could borrow up to $2.5 million. We only borrowed $1.8 million. The bad news is now they want their money back. It was not an easy time because the Great Recession, real estate recession, hit just in the middle 80s. And a lot of our people were in real estate. Anyway, Gary tells a story about that property and where it was located. Oh, and by the way, a part of the reason we only borrowed $1.8 million is that we had an extraordinary gift from one of our members, a man named John Lloyd, who had owned the property adjacent to us, which is now the Rob Roy development. The people at Barton Creek Country Club, that was being developed, Governor Connally and Governor Barnes were developing that country club, that whole area. They needed a road from Big Cave Road down through their property. So the deal was made that John would give to the church. Turned out to be about 40 acres in total, a strip running from to make that road, which is now Barton Creek Boulevard, to make that road accessible. He donated that strip to the church, which we immediately sold to the Barnes Connally development for $650,000. That helped let us finish, essentially, the church. Now, that's an image of the church at that time. An interesting story, and I'll share it with you quickly. We're going to run out of time here in a minute. I need to move along. Gary was negotiating with Will Cowan. I'm talking to Will Cowan about the property. It was a part of the process. Later, of course, he knew Barnes Connally wanted the same property. And he always wondered why Will Cowan sold it to us as opposed to Barnes Connally. Well, he ran into when Corey, their little boy, was dying of Burkitt's lymphoma. They had sent him to Switzerland for experimental treatment. Of course, he died shortly after that. But during that time, Gary and Sarah were in Switzerland, and they took a break and were in Paris. And they ran into, of all people, Will Cowley. As he tells the story, he said, I couldn't believe it. We're at the Louvre. There's Will Cowan of all people. He said, Will, what are you doing here? And he said, well, I'm spending the church's money. And he said, well, I've always wondered why you told it to us as opposed to Barnes Conley. And his answer was, he said, well, as it turned out, Will Cowan and his little house down there in his basement made wine. And Gary said it was the most awful stuff you could imagine. But he would drink it. And Will Cowan told Gary, Ben Barnes would never drink my wine. And that tipped the balance apparently in favor of us. So God works in mysterious ways. Well, anyway, the church continued to grow. This is an image in 19 of the dedication of the bell tower. And here we have Reverend Lee Bowman, the magnificent Dorothy Depew, Cecil Johnson, Bibby Gribble Cook, the daughter of Dr. Gribble, one of the founders. Of course, our pastor, Cody Marshall, Marilyn Edwards Akaba, and Bruce Marshall, all families that trace their roots back to the very beginning. Gathering here together for the dedication of that bell tower. And I might point out that Lee Bowman was the first woman called as a pastor by Westlake Press. That was trailbreaking. And their story was, as a young girl in the congregation, the first time she saw Lee at the pulpit, said to her mama, Mama, I didn't know girls could be pastors. They want to change for the better, I might add. Corey's death occurred in 1980. When we built the church, we built and brought with us these iconic references from our history. And you still find these images around the facility, including up here at the top, the Eanes Church, the Central Texas Presbytery, organized in 1923. That's from the cornerstone. The Fellowship Hall, 57. And at your feet, under one plaque, is this Celtic cross and stone. The stones are from the island of Iona. And Iona was the historic home and monastery of a famous monk by the name of Columba, Saint Columba. Paul and I visited. And he was important in our, in the movement, in the history of the church in Europe. The church bell came with us from every year we moved. And of course, the Celtic cross is a symbol that is important to the Presbyterian community. Gary accepted a call to La Cunada Presbyterian Church in 1990. And we then called as an interim the Reverend Jack Lancaster, who had retired. Well, let me pause for a moment. Here's the other iconic figures. The baptismal font was actually produced in memory of Corey Dennis. And it was a copy, a replica of the baptismal font of the Grossmünster Church in Zurich, Switzerland. And we've actually visited that church, and I went down and looked at that original baptismal font. Not nearly as pretty as ours is, but it's the same shape and the same design. And in addition to losing Corey, the Edwards family, bless them, were working to have a family. And Christy Engelman will remember this, I know very well. And tragically, they had two sets of triplets. And all but one of them died. Only one of those six children survived. So our pastors were enduring great loss during this time of all this activity occurring within our congregation. The associates that Gary had were important, and this highlights some of them. Bill Edwards, obviously. Mike DiRuta was called as an assistant pastor, which was a term, a formal office that we no longer have in the Presbyterian Church. An assistant pastor could be hired and not called, essentially. Mike was with us for a few years. Lee Bowman, of course. Cleve Wheelis was our first experience with a parish associate. Retired pastor who could come and serve and fill the special needs. And we've continued to benefit from parish associates all for the last 4 years. These two guys at the bottom, Ted Worley was the youth director. He went on, he graduated from Austin Seminary, went on to a distinguished career and now retired as Presbyterian pastor. And of course, Larry Colton. Some of you I know remember Larry. He was gifted, a leader, charismatic, and a little C. He went on to graduate. We sent him to Princeton. He graduated from Princeton. He went on to serve churches in California, Houston, and at Shepherd of the Hills Presbyterian here in Austin. And then he felt a call to the Lakeway Church, where he is today. Non-denominational, but has a Presbyterian identity. And it's extraordinarily successful. This is a part of what a large church can do, is it helps to train and prepare younger people for their life in the parish. Because seminary, Austin is the Austin Presbyterian Theological Seminary. The things they teach about parish ministry, what it means to work and be in the parish, requires supplemental help, basically. And of course, with Kevin, we have an example today of the same kind of phenomenon. One of the developments out of Gary's ministry was the Second Street ministry. And this was a group of women led by June Davis and Ellen Reese, who began taking donuts down to day workers on Second Street. That became, ultimately grew significantly into a program where we brought them out to our church where they could shower, we could give them food and could feed them. And a classic kind of outreach ministry. This grew to the point where other churches joined and it became the foundation for the homeless, which exists today, still serving a significant part of the homeless in Austin. This is a great tribute. And every year, I hope all of you can make a donation to the Foundation of the Homeless, in part in memory of Morris Davis, June's faithful husband, both of whom are longtime members of Westlake Press. Now, the other thing that's happened is we have marvelous children's programs. We really do. And this is a picture of 1 year as they were beginning for Vacation Bible School. I have now from Cindy Gangstead in particular, boxes of photographs that she's given us, lent me to use. We can't possibly, I'd love to be able to produce all of them in a book. But yeah, I can't. It'd be an encyclopedia. But it's wonderful stories, wonderful places to look and see the images of these kids and how they were cared for and taught year after year after year. And the new facility actually made all of these things possible. You think about it. There was no way we could have brought these people to our old church at the corner of Westlake Drive to shower, to have meals, to enjoy, to benefit from that, or for the places where we have this kind of programming. These are some other photographs of over the years of that program. And then we had something called the Beehive. The Beehive, I don't actually have an active memory of it, but the Beehive was a program for older citizens. They came together to play cards and do one thing or another. And it lasted for a number of years. And this is an image of some of the women who were part of that. And it had an echo in a way of the gathering, which was developed some years later. And the library, again, the life of the mind. A library has been an important part of our history for a long time. And it finally was given the room to actually develop appropriately. And now it's overflowing. You go and see that library, there's not a space on a shelf available. Mo Ranch has always been a part of our history, a part of the Presbyterian history in this area. It was acquired by the Presbyterian Church in 1949. It's about 500 acres on the Guadalupe River. And almost every year, we've had an all-church retreat at Bull Ranch and have enjoyed the fellowship and the fun and the beauty of that place, the outdoor chapel. Yeah, I don't know who that is, but he had a little trouble with the ropes. These are the kids going off in June of 1982 for a trip to Colorado. Now, from 83 to 1990, this chart gives you an idea of the growth of our church. From 83, from the time of the move, our membership at the time of the move, out of about 83, was at just under 1,000. By the time that Gary left, it was at 1,800. When Gary came in 76, the membership was closer to 400. So he basically gave us his contribution, if you will, was that emphasis on youth growing, a commitment to Bible study, the addition of the ability to do more in mission. And of course, all that was made possible, no small part, by the relocation. When Gary left to take a call to La Cunada Presbyterian Church in 1990, where, by the way, he retired about 5 years ago after a long and distinguished career. We called Jack Lancaster, who was retired as pastor of First Houston, as our interim. He was here for 2 years. He helped retire the debt that he had inherited, and he provided a really significant leadership. He was a gift to us. Jack knew the church because he had served at First Southern. He knew the church. He was actually on the installation committee for some of our pastors. So when he came, he had some understanding. But he was a terrific interim. And then Doug Fletcher. Doug was called in 1992, and he served for 15 years. Doug was at Southminster Pres in Tulsa when we found him. He came as a recommendation really from Andy Dearman, who was a professor at Austin Seminary, who had an iconic Bible study class at Westlake. He recommended we ought to take a look at this guy. And we did. And when Doug came, the first thing, among the things he did, is that we, by this time, our facilities were actually getting a little older. and they're being used. We had a lot of people there. And so we began a campaign. This was in 98. And you can see the people, this were celebrating the commitment to the vision, another fund drive. You can see the people playing, people that were active in the congregation. And that we raised about $2.25 million to finance needed expansion, including renovation of the sanctuary to accommodate the organ. The new organ was financed separately from private gifts, but it required a renovation of the sanctuary, and we took that opportunity to change out the pews and some other things. It was extensive. And by the way, that organ, I mean, it is an extraordinary gift. And it's well known among organists. And we do an organ recital every year where we invite guest organists to come in and enjoy and play that remarkable instrument. So over the 15 years of Doc's ministry, we experienced an explosion in mission programs. Again, our membership at that time by 2007 was about approaching 2,500. And a big church can do many things, has great capacity. And in 2004, which is this image, our mission budget was $570,000. Or about 18% of our total receipts. And today that commitment to mission continues. And we regularly at least tithe our annual giving, our annual receipts to mission programs. And you can see some examples of them here. 1983, an adult trip, team trip to Piedras Negras. You can see Morris Davis, Pat and Cindy Shannon, John and Kathy Doty, and others were part of that trip. Here we are, a mission trip to Peru. I see Jim and Kathy Little in this picture. I think Jim and Kathy, they were here. They're back there. There they are. Okay. So, yeah. Do you remember that trip? Jim Berkey and Steve Wilbrand attending to a dental care. This is Brad Winiger, wow, with a girl at the deaf school. I talked to Brad recently about his experiences, and he shared this with me. He said, you know, when we were in those countries, so there was a place I visited, they called it the dump. And it was where stuff was dumped, but people were living there, living out of these places, out of makeshift homes, places, houses. And he said he met this woman who was simply at peace. And he asked her. And she said, well, you know, I have my faith and I have enough for my family. And that's all I need. And he said, Brad said to me, that changed my life. That changed my life. From that moment forward, I never valued things in the same way. I saw what was important. And this is the way mission works. Almost always, the people who are giving without intention receive more than they give. An extraordinary experience. Another, the Austin Samaritans. John Doty, another physician, out of his travels to Peru and others, carrying mission programs forward, he established Austin Samaritans as a separate organization, which continues today, serving as a nonprofit. And he gave up his practice to be a part of Austin Samaritans. Again, it started in our church. The African ministry, another of those. The prison fellowship. Something that I don't think many of you may have known we had, where we had pastors and lay people, including Wally Warrenberg, who visited the prisons to show some level of compassion and concern for people who were incarcerated. Manos de Cristo is still a program our church supports. There's the lovely Flo Macklin at the Barbara Caney House, and Nancy Douglas, part of the Crop Walk. Again, outreach programs. And of course, the Gathering. Those of you that are familiar with the Gathering, hugely important step in development. And this all occurred during Doug's tenure as our pastor. These are the associates that served with Doug at different times. Bob Bullock, Steve Wilbraham, Peg Catwell, Nancy Fox, Herb Taines is a parish associate, Clint Region, Carol Friesen, and Peter Hawes. All of whom have had their own careers in ministry. Today, Clint Region is the senior pastor at Wimberley Presbyterian Church. Bob Bullock recently retired from Little Church in Galveston. Peter Haas is now an interim pastor at a church in San Antonio. Membership from 92 to 2007, as I said earlier, just continued to grow. So by the time of Doug, we were reaching 2,500 people. And here's the two of them together. When you think about that period of time, Gary and Doug, between them, had more than 30 years in ministry, essentially establishing the modern Presbyterian Westlake Press as we know it today. They were there, those two long pastors. That 30 years represents 20% of our 150-year history. And of the modern church, actually, substantially more than that, if we take it back to 1954. Then we experienced a period of transition, a 10-year period where at least one of our pastors said the church is searching for its identity. These are wonderful people. They really are. Joe Rottmeyer came as an interim, was succeeded by Peter Barnes. When Peter left, the great Al Kriminacher stepped in as our interim. We called Mark Ramsey. He was here for 2 years. And one of the great gifts that Mark made was to bring and call and hire the Reverend Stacy Eichhardt. Who brought extraordinary stories to our church and was there when Mark had the need to leave. And so the Presbyterian grievance, look, we don't need an interim. We have Stacy. And the Presbyterian quickly agreed that she became our acting head of staff until 1918 when we could call Italy. In this period of time, was one of a particular issue within the Presbyterian Church that we've been dealing with for 30 years and had to do with the ordination of self-affirming gay people, gay and lesbian people, and the blessing of same-sex marriages. Those were the issues. And they were dividing the church. They had been for a long time. And we were sorting our way through that at exactly that time. And for more than 37 years, we were divided by that debate. Ultimately, our church remained within the PCUSA, essentially affirming its acceptance of the ability of ordaining bodies to ordain within their conscience the people they believe fit the call, regardless of their orientation. but it's a local option. No pastor is required to marry anybody his conscience doesn't permit. No session is required to host a wedding they don't agree. No ordaining body is forced to ordain somebody that they believe is inappropriate for whatever reason. This is the system we came through. But during that period of time, there were pastors in great good faith and sessions and other congregations who just simply disagreed with that, who believed that homosexuality was wrong regardless of the context. And as a result of that, a new Presbyterian denomination evolved called ECO, the Evangelical Covenant Order of Presbyterians. And it was very painful because many of the churches, iconic churches within Texas, as well as the rest, primarily the South, left to join ECO, including such places as Highland Park Presbyterian Church, where many of our congregants had a history. Many of our pastors had taught there. First Church Houston, Grace Church Houston, and others. It was a great loss. First Church San Antonio. Many of us had served with these people and knew them well. But the fact is that we are a schismatic group of people. Presbyterian churches have been dividing and coming back together for centuries. It's nothing new. This is a picture, and this is approximately 2020. These data are a little elusive and hard to grab, but basically it shows you the largest of 10 Presbyterian denominations in the United States today. And still, PCUSA, of which we are a member, is by far the largest. Here are the pastors that served during this interim period of time. Carol Friesen, Peter Haas, Jim Burkhead, Chris Knapp stepped forward as a parish associate, Amy and Mark Charbonneau. Membership during this period of time declined. This was the period of time when we were searching, and the membership began. And by the time Emily was called, we were just under 2,000 members. And here she is, a lovely, extremely talented, charismatic leader, Emily Wright. These are the worshiping team, so to speak. Stacy, Kevin, Stephen, and Emily. The music program has been an exceptional part of our life in the church. This is an image of Emily leading the chancel choir of the chamber orchestra at Christmas time. And she's also successfully brought together a praise service that divides many churches and made space for this kind of music within our services. These are folks who have served the church for more than 10 years, including people sitting in our audience right now. And that's really a gift, if you think about it. The pastors come, the pastors go. We've had this staff who helped support this church in each case for more than 20 years. And we're grateful. There are Sunday school classes today that are, we call them legacy classes because they've been around a long time. One of them is contemplative Christianity, which actually is a different form of spiritual development that traces its roots back to the earliest days of the Christian movement. The third well has been there for a long, long time, and you can see some of the leaders on the right-hand side. And I would point out to you that's unique in a way. And one of these is Sandy Criss. Mm-hmm. Sandy is Jewish. But he's a scholar. And he's taught, he taught a one-year program at Third Well on basically the Old Testament, the Talmud, working through it. He's a gifted scholar, and he's been a great friend of our church. And men's morning, Tuesday morning, men's program, this is for the young guys. And then there is the senior men's Bible study for the old guys. And there's a reminiscence about that program by Bill Holloway, who joined the group in 92. And it's existing prior to that time, for some period of time. But he's continued to serve as our leader of that class for all of these years. And for that, we are grateful. This is the pattern for 1956. Or 1960, excuse me, to 2022. And you can see the growth in the church over those first 30 years. And then our decline during that 10-year period, and now it's beginning to stabilize. We're still a very large church and a very healthy congregation with an awful lot to offer and a lot to give. This is a look at where we are today. This church itself, the sanctuary, the table and the pulpit, by the way, were designed and built by Arlen Carter, a longtime member at that time of the church. The baptismal font, the organ, extraordinary gift. The outside renovations that occurred over time, the bell tower, and the memorial garden. The last of the major developments is the memorial garden, which exists just to the north of the sanctuary. And it provides both places for in-ground and the columbarium niches to receive the ashes, and has an emerging memorial wall to memorialize those people, to identify them who may be buried or interred somewhere else. This is a special ministry. And the two guys sitting here, Paul, have been extremely important in carrying that forward, as has Stacy Ocker. It's a wonderful, wonderful place. I would encourage you, if you're not, sometime to visit. That's a look over the hills and a perspective over time. This is, we'll close with this. But again, I'd ask these reminiscences from people. I got this one back from a longtime member who had returned to the church, Susan Bergbrayer, who had been, prior to Emily, she'd actually been a part of our choir program. And she wrote, she's reflecting on this, and I'll just read briefly from it. She talked about what changes have taken place since 92 when she left. And then here she says, here are some of the things that have not changed. We're still a thinking, inclusive congregation, dedicated to serving with hearts and minds and hands and feet. We're a church rooted in the love of Christ, the forgiveness of Christ, the resurrection of each of us as we travel this road of ups and downs on our various journeys. We're a community bound by love and by hope. We believe in bringing the love and forgiveness of Jesus to those who do not know the Spirit and carry no hope inside themselves. We're a community that stands by one another through sickness and grief and pandemics. We teach kindness to our children. We bring Jesus to others. Finally, I believe we're a community that will bond together to lessen the fears that dominate our world. We will stay rooted in Christ and love. we will have hope and we will have a lack of fear. And we will get through the dark times and the good times as a community of love. And all God's people said, amen.